morning, we might lift up a word from the Gospel according to Mark, 5th chapter. I'd like to read just a portion of the verses that we've read. I'd like to begin 35th verse. While he was still speaking, some came from the ruler of the synagogue's house, who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" And as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not be afraid, only believe." And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Then he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw a tumult, those who wept and wailed loudly. When he came in, he said to them, "Why make this commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they ridiculed. But when he had put them all aside, he took the father and the mother of the child and those who were with him and entered where the child was laid. Then he took the child by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kumi," which is interpreted, "Little girl, I say unto you, arise." The word of God. Father, I stretch my hand, for there is no other help that I know. Lord, as we stand in your presence, we thank you for your presence here today. We thank you, Lord, for the singing of the songs of Zion and the prayers that have gone up. Lord, we come now to the moment of the shared word. Lord, it's my prayer that you will move through this sanctuary, up and down these aisles and through these pews to touch the hearts of your people. For it's not about lunch after services, but it's about your work, which can feed us, feed our hungry souls. Lord, we pray that you give understanding, wisdom, and knowledge. And I ask that you purge me now with your Holy Spirit. And I will be clean. Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. Let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Be seated. I'd like to share with you today a sermon topic. Only believe. Jesus said, "If you do believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Whosoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God." If you want to see the experience, the glory of God, you must believe in Jesus the Christ. Have I got a witness here this morning? When looking at Webster for a definition of this word believe, Webster says that believe, that is B-E-L-I-E-F, is a noun. And it shows mental acceptance of something and places confidence or trust in a person or thing. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. As Christians, it is our belief that God is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He is our heavenly Father. There are many religions all over the world and many people who are worshiping God perhaps more diligently than we. But we are Christians because it is our belief that the Bible is the inspired It is our belief that Jesus is the Messiah, the one who was to come. He is the Christ, the Son of the living God. He lived and died here on this earth that you and I might have the right to eternal life. It is our belief that he is coming back again, just like he said. Webster also says that the word faith is also a noun. To have faith implies certainty, full trust and confidence, whether there is objective evidence or not. Faith and belief are very similar in that they are both nouns. And their definitions are very close to being the same. The Bible encourages us to have faith in God. In spite of the fact that we cannot see him with our natural eyes, faith comes by hearing the word of God. But when we look in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 7, we find the word of God telling us to walk by faith and not by sight. Now, as we go a little further, the word believe is a verb. B-E-L-I-E-V-E. It's a verb which shows action or a state of being. We've got some English teachers in here that could tell us about these words and what they mean in our lives. It's a difficult thing to separate having faith that God is from belief that he has the ability to do whatever he wants to do. God can do whatever he wants to do. Amen, church. As Christians, we are encouraged. It is commanded by God that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. And then he commands us to love one another as he gave us command. The scripture has concluded that the promises of God are given by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. Believing is the thing that brings action on the scene. If you say that you believe that chairs are designed and built to sit on to rest your weary body, and you choose to stand all the time, never giving trust to sit down in a chair, you really don't believe that that chair can do what it has been designed to do. I pray that this is making sense to somebody. Amen. Amen. You came in here this morning and you saw all these nice big padded pews. You knew that they were there for you to sit on. And guess what? You found your place to sit down. And you are there right now. If you say that God created food for the nourishment of our bodies, and you never make any effort to put the tiniest morsel in your mouth, I'm telling you, you're missing out on countless blessings, and you're on your way out of this world. Have I got a witness in here? Amen. Amen. You can look at God's table and his bounty and smell the fragrance of fried chicken and whatever else that may be there, and refuse to put any in your mouth. Something is going to take place. Amen. Amen. Somebody will be looking at you and be wondering what happened. You don't look the same. because you'll be losing so much weight and body functions will begin to change. And before you know it, you'll be out of here. But I come to tell you, if you believe that God has done what he's done for your good, when that table is prepared, you're going to partake. And you're going to be blessed. As we look in 2 Chronicles, the 20th chapter, King Jehoshaphat stood and exhorted. He encouraged the inhabitants of Judah and of Jerusalem, saying, "Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper." The word of God came to the prophet Isaiah saying, "If you will not believe, surely you shall not be established." The problem that many Christians suffer from today is no different than the nature of the many thousands that gathered around Jesus as he walked and ministered upon the earth. Many believed and many came from the north, south, east and west, to eat and to be healed, and to bask in the presence of his glory. But when it came to the point of putting their belief into action, the point where the rubber meets the road, the Bible said that many of them turned back. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except by me. I am that bread of life. I am that living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." The Bible lets us know that from that moment, many disciples allow their hearts to become filled with disbelief and misunderstanding. Many people today have been drawn by the Spirit of God unto Christ to eat of that bread of life and to experience blessings and peace and joy, only to turn back when asked to put their belief into action by serving the Lord in a physical way. Not sitting with the Lord, but putting their purpose that he made all of us for into action. And I say all the time, God has given all of us a purpose. Amen. Amen, amen. We're going to have to come before his presence one day. We're going to have to give an account of what we have done with the gift that God has given to us. Amen. We're not going to be able to stand in his presence and give excuses that I wasn't given an opportunity. No one called my name. No one invited me to come up share and to serve. But God has given all of us a gift and a purpose. And we have the responsibility to find our place and to serve God in spirit and in truth. There was a man called Jairus who was a ruler of the synagogue. And when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. How did that man come? He came seeking. He came searching. He came asking. He came praying, saying, "My little daughter lies at the point of death. I pray that you come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live." Jesus had compassion and went with Jairus. And while Jesus was on the way to attend to Jairus' daughter, there was another, a woman in the crowd, who came filled with faith and believing to experience the glory of God. She came having been sick for 12 long years with an issue of blood. And she had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all that she had. And instead of getting better, the Bible lets us know that she grew worse. That woman heard that there was a man in town who had power that no one could question. For he was healing the sick. He was making the lame to walk. He was casting out demons. He could speak and bring peace out of a storm. How did that woman come? She came looking. She came searching. She came pressing her way through the crowd. She came believing in her heart and saying with her lips, if I may just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. The Bible said that when she found him, she reached through and touched him. She reached out and she touched him. And you know the thing that we experience in the Christian community, nobody wants to tell anybody about their struggles. Folk can get sick, go into the hospital, be in ICU room, and come out after a long stay and say, Pastor, you didn't come to see me. Well, my question is, who did you take? Who did you reach out to and let somebody know that you had a need? Oh, I come to tell you, St. John, there is a sin that's called pride. I hope somebody hears what I'm saying. There is a sin that's called pride. And you know that angel that was up in heaven, and he had a struggle with God. He was put out of heaven because of pride. God wants to bless you, St. John. Amen. But the enemy wants to lock up your lips and keep you from saying anything. Keep you from asking. Keep you from reaching out. Keep you from letting somebody know that you have a need. Well, God uses people. And if you feel like you can handle it on your own, you're going to miss a blessing that God has for you through a child, through a stranger. But you've got to open your mouth and let somebody know. Have I got a witness in here? Amen. Amen. I don't want to rock you to sleep. I'm not going to keep you too long. But we're talking about some things that can help all of us. God has given us a mouth. And we need to open that mouth and give him praise and ask him for what we stand in need of. That woman came through the crowd and she could have been stoned to death. But because she had heard that there was a man in town that could do anything. Jesus can do anything. But you've got to believe. And what that belief and that believing is all about is not sitting somewhere in a room and expecting that somebody's going to have a crystal ball and know everything that's going on with you.
tell you, if you let me know, I'll be there, and the Lord so will you. God is able. God has blessings that he wants to pour out on his people. But that sin called pride is causing so many to miss out on what God wants to do in your life. And as a result of receiving the blessing of God, God wants you to tell somebody. Amen. Well, I've already said that faith comes by hearing. And so if God has done something miraculous in your life, you ought to tell somebody. You ought to give God the glory. You ought to put your hands together. You ought to worship him in the sanctuary. Not be ashamed to let somebody know that God came by. And he took care of my every need. Amen. That woman was healed. That woman was delivered. The Bible said that straightway, once she had touched him, the fountain of blood was dried up. She was healed. And Jesus said unto her, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Go in peace and be whole of your faith. I don't care what anybody says. Jesus is all right with me. Have I got a witness in me? That was no doubt a touching scene. And it reminds me of a song that means so much to me. The writer said, pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. While Jesus was still talking to the woman, servants of Jairus came and said to Jairus, your daughter is dead. Why trouble the master any further? But when Jesus heard the words that were spoken, he said to Jairus, be not afraid, only believe. Believers are encouraged throughout the Bible by God to not be afraid of men and circumstances, but rather have faith and trust in God. Fear is a torment. Fear breeds doubt. And God will prevent you from receiving your blessing. Jesus goes on and he takes Peter, James, and John to Jairus' house. And when he got there, the crowd was weeping and wailing. And Jesus said, why are you making this ado? Weeping, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping. And you know what? The crowd made fun of Jesus. The Bible said they laughed him to scorn. The Bible said that Jesus put them all out. There are times in our lives when it seems that it makes no difference how much we try to do our best in living for the Lord. People that we know, people that we love and trust, as well as those who don't know us, will make fun of us. They will sometimes laugh us to scorn. They will talk about us. They will say all manner of evil against us because they don't like us. When people don't like you, they can be so cruel. Have I got a witness here? But I come to tell you that night is equated with hate. And hate can be equated with being a murderer. And the Bible says that murderers do not have eternal life in them. I tell you, the enemy, he's working. to guard our minds. We've got to keep all of that worldly junk and garbage out of our system.
Amen.
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 You know, folks don't want to fellowship in the church anymore. Folks are scared to reach out and touch one another. Don't want to shake each other's hand. Don't want to give a hug because somebody thinks something negative about you. But I come to tell you, if you belong to Jesus, He has given us a command to love God with all of our heart and mind and spirit, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. Have I got a witness in here?
Amen.
Amen. We, the followers of Jesus Christ, we must learn to put those hurts, those pains, those disappointments away from us. And remember that I said the hurts, pains, and disappointments. God wants us to love our enemies and pray for them that the love and the mercy of God will touch their lives. Because if somebody is treating you bad, they don't know Jesus in the way they should.
Right.
Have I got a word?
Amen.
There are times when we didn't love God the way we love Him right now. I know I should have a witness in here. You don't have to worry about saying amen. Because all of us have shrugged our shoulders when God came knocking and saying, "Come unto me." And we shrugged our shoulder and said, "Not today, Lord. Maybe next month. Maybe next year after I've gotten some things straightened out." Well, I come to tell you, the only way that we can get the world out of our system is by inviting the Spirit of God in Christ to come in and have His way. So we've got to come just as we are. Whatever the world has put upon us, we've got to come just as we are. And just say, "Lord, have mercy upon me, a sinner." The Bible said that Jesus took the mother and father, Peter, James, and John, and went and into the room, and He took the girl by the hand and said, "Damsel, I say unto you, arise." And the Bible said that she got up and walked. I tell you, God is able. Oh, our God is able. Things don't look the same. They don't look the same as they look to God. The people were weeping over separation and a family funeral. But Jesus saw a family reunion. I tell you, if you want to see the glory of God, you must believe. Whosoever believes on Jesus shall not be ashamed. Today the Christian church is experiencing the same disbelief and departure by would-be disciples of Jesus as He experienced a long time ago. It's not a question of faith and belief, which provides a basis, a foundation, or a starting point by which one may move into this Christian arena. It is a matter of believing what God has said in His Word, in the Bible.
Yes.
But if believers don't know what God says as He promises us life, how can we trust in God to do what He said He would do? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If you are or would be a follower of Jesus Christ, when he says, I am the Messiah. I am the bread of life. I am from above. I am the eternal one. I am the light of the world. I am the door, and no one can get to the Father except by me. I am the Son of God. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the Lord and Master. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the first and the last. Following Jesus is a thing of action. It is impossible to know him and not be moved to action. To know him is to serve him. To know him is to love him. To love, love is not something that we just sing about. Love is something that you show. You can tell me that you love me 24/7.